All right, so everyone, welcome to our last lecture and our last lab for this week's course. Today we are going to finish what we've learned about forces and about our solar system model. And then we are going to move on to a demonstration of the actual solar system model with multiple planets and the interactions between all the planets fully taken into account. And so an outline for today, we are going to learn how to calculate all the interactions between each planet. So not just from the sun to the earth, but from the earth to Mars, from the earth to Jupiter, from the earth to the moon, all these things. And today we're going to take out all of our simplifying assumptions. So we're not going to have any simplifying assumptions. So like, for example, the sun is going to move, all the planets are going to move correctly, and we're going to get rid of all of our simplifying assumptions from the past. Now the code that we're going to demonstrate to you today, you can use this method to model any planet or any star in any solar system. You can even use it to model satellites. You can use it to model moons. You can use it to do whatever you want. And then finally today, we'll demonstrate the code and we'll change some of the initial conditions to create some interesting scenarios that we can use to test our understanding of physics and planetary motion. So remember from Monday that our final goal was to get to building the large full solar system model that would look something like this. So this is our end goal, and today we are going to be wrapping everything up and aiming for this end goal.
We have a question.
Yes.
Sorry, that's not the same code that we're, is this MATLAB versus
Yes.
Octave? Because it looks different.
This is not the exact same thing that we're going to be doing right now, but it's very close. This was written in something called MATLAB, which is very similar to Octave, but just a little different. And so today we're going to be doing a very similar model, but in Octave. And also, if you want to use this exact code, MATLAB is normally a paid service, but there is a free trial. And if you choose to get the free trial, we can send you a copy of this, of the code that produces this. So anyone that wants this full version, we can send you the code and you can try it out on MATLAB if you so choose. And so today, what we're finally going to do today is we are going to understand the planet-to-planet interactions. So each planet not only feels the force from the sun, but it also feels some gravitational force from all the other planets. Right now, we've only been dealing with the force between the Earth and the sun, which is shown right here. You see the Earth here. And the only force we know of is the force from the Earth to the Sun here. However, in the real solar system, there are many different objects, and all these different objects are exerting a force onto the Earth. So for example, Mercury exerts a force on the Earth. Mercury has mass, and because it has mass, it's going to exert a gravitational force on the Earth, and that force might be in a different direction than what the Sun is. And so this, for example, would be the force of Mercury on the Earth. And then we can do this for all the other planets. So we can have the force on the Earth from Venus, the force on the Earth from the Moon, the force on the Earth from Mars, and the force on the Earth from Jupiter. And so in order to get the total force on Earth, here, F Earth, what we do is we take all of these forces and add them up. And what we'll get is one total force that will be the sum of all of these other forces. So does anyone have any questions on how the Earth experiences one total force from all of these smaller forces?
I have a question, because it just seems like the moon force seems to me like it will be different because it's going around the Earth, and the other ones.
The force from the moon will constantly be rotating. This little arrow will constantly be rotating, kind of like a needle on a clock, because the moon's constantly going around the Earth.
Yeah.
But it's treated the exact same way as any of the other forces. Even though it moves differently, it's treated with the exact same laws of physics. It's treated with the same Newton's law of gravity that all of the other forces are treated with. And this doesn't just happen for the Earth. This also happens for every other planet. So for example, if we have Mars, the force on Mars, the total force on Mars, is composed of the force from the Sun, the force from Mercury, the force from Venus, the force from Phobos, which is a moon of Mars. So kind of like the Earth has its moon, Mars has Phobos. Additionally, it's composed of the force from Earth and the force from Jupiter. And so this shows that not only does the Earth have to deal with multiple forces, but all the other planets, just like the Earth and just like Mars, have to deal with multiple forces. And so the code that we are going to show you later today is going to demonstrate how to program these multiple forces into our model and then create a graph that shows many different planets going around the Sun and how they interact with each other. And so right now we're going to give everyone a little bit of time to open up our first program that we sent you, which is going to be the three body problem program. And so I will show you.
But version B, Bravo, right? Version Bravo? B.
Yes.
Okay, the second one.
Yes. Yes. And before we start working with this, I just want to show people a little feature that can help everyone if they need it. So does everyone have open in their Octave three body problem version 07172020B?
Leo, I just clicked on it and then I downloaded it and then it automatically opened in Octave. That's all I had to do?
Yes.
Yeah, me too.
Okay, good.
Yes, that's all you have to do. So just double click on it and it will open.
Mine is loading.
All right, that's fine.
So now I have two octaves open.
Anyone who doesn't come to a page that looks like this, please tell me and we'll help you with this. Now, does anyone not have this page, three body problem, on their Octave?
I'm trying to open it, but it doesn't seem to be like running or loading. It just, I pressed download and nothing happened. I have some other stuff open, but
I can help you. I can help you with that. I'll you can share your screen and I'll I'll tell you what to do.
So this is what I see. This is from yesterday.
Yeah.
But I clicked download and I open it with Octave and nothing happens.
Nothing happens. So can you go back to the email? Can you go back to the full email? Yeah. Like that. Can you go back to the email that we sent you? Not that one. The one that was most recently sent to you.
Yeah, this is the one that my mom forwarded.
No, this one has the two body problem. Can you go back to your inbox? And can you go up? Can you click on the very top email in the inbox?
My mom copy and pasted this one.
Oh.
Well, we can copy and paste. Yeah, so what we can do, we can help you with this. So what you can do, you can copy this entire email.
I'll add a percentage.
Yeah. What we'll do is we'll create a new, program, file, new script, and then you can just paste it right in there. Add a little percentage sign.
And another slash.
Or you don't need the slash. All you just need is the percentage sign in front of it.
Oh, my bad. Like that?
Yes. Now I just want to make sure that you have the correct code. Can you go downwards on your... Can you keep going downwards? I just want to make sure you have the correct code. Oh, you had the code. Please stop. You had the code that we sent out earlier. And so I'll tell you how to fix it. I'll tell you how to fix it really quickly. So the way that we fix this code is we first, you see your lines 88 and 89?
Yeah.
Can you highlight everything in those lines and delete them, please? All right, then can you go to your lines 99 and 100? And can you delete those, please? And then can you go to lines 110 and 111 and delete those, please? And that should be it. Now you... That was the bug that we sent a fix for in one of the emails. Just go up to the top of the program for a second, just to make sure. All right, I think you're good then. You can stop sharing your screen and we can...
Should I run it?
Not right now. Well, I'm first going to demonstrate what everything does. And then we'll have people run it. So can everyone see my screen right here?
Yes.
All right. And so I think everyone has, because what we've done, everyone has this version up here. If you haven't copied and pasted it and you've downloaded it, it should be it should say version B up here. I've corrected mine, but we sent out a fixed version that says version B in the email. And so I'll explain. And so what this program does is it adds in a third body to demonstrate how we add up the forces. And so this third body is going to be Mercury. So what we first need to do is we need to know how far Mercury starts away from the sun. And this number tells us how far Mercury is. Just like we did with the Earth, we give Mercury an initial distance. And then again, just like we did with the Earth, we give Mercury an initial mass right here. And this mass will always stay the same throughout the entire program. And for everyone's code, can you just make sure that M Mercury, the mass of Mercury, is equal to 3.3 e to the 23rd, and that M Earth is equal to 5.97 times e to the 24th? Because I think that the older version of the code had different masses for these, and they were incorrect. And so everyone just make sure that the mass of Mercury is 3.3 e to the 23rd, and the mass of the Earth is 5.97 e to the 24th. And so what these do is they set our masses for the original two bodies, the sun and the Earth. We always knew that. And then it sets our mass for our new body, Mercury. And now what we have here is we have our delta time. And this delta time is the exact same. We use the exact same procedure that we did in our two-body problem, our complete two-body problem, and all of those. So this stays exactly the same.
So my cone is, I think, so for my, ZNT max, it equals 365 times 24 times 4.
Oh, well, that means, all right, that's perfectly fine, but what that times 4 means that you're, the program is going to calculate the position every quarter of an hour. And what that means, it's going to be more accurate. However, it's going to take slower on your computer. It's going to run slower on your computer. And so if you want it to run faster, you take away that times four. And if you want it to be more accurate, you keep the times four and you can even increase it. So you can do times 60. But the more the CNT max is, the larger that this number is, the more accurate it will be, but the slower it will run. It will run much slower.
Thank you.
And so I think on most computers, a reasonable accuracy and speed would just be 365 times 24. But if you know you have a really good computer, then you can add on times 4 or times 10 or whatever. And that will allow you to get a more accurate program at the cost of more time. And so now we'll continue on to the different parts of our code and see what's changed and what stayed the same. So our next block is our sun memory allocation, basically making the empty pages in our flipbook for the sun. This stays exactly the same. We aren't changing anything about the empty pages for the sun. See here that this block has stayed exactly the same. This block has stayed exactly the same as we did yesterday. So there's nothing new with this. Now we move down below to look at our Mercury memory allocation. This is the exact same blank page block that we did for the sun and the Earth, but now we're doing the exact same thing for Mercury. So this is the exact same as all of these other ones, with the only difference being this little M, and that stands for Mercury. And so that's the only difference between what we did yesterday and what we're doing today, that we're adding this new block. And then as we go on, we see our old block for the empty pages for the Earth, the exact same that we did yesterday. And now what we're gonna do is we're going to look at our initial forces. Now remember that our forces are going to be different today because we're adding up multiple forces. We don't just have one force anymore from each planet. Now there's a third planet, and that third planet is going to be imparting a force onto the sun and the earth. And so this is how we do that. So first we're going to find all the forces on the sun for the first time step, remember. This is all for the first time step. We first set it equal to zero to clear out this one value. Then what we do is we then calculate the force on the sun from Mercury using our Newton's law of gravity equation right here. And this just shows that the force now is equal to what it was, and then we're adding on to this our force from Mercury. And then the next line adds in our force, adds in our force from the Earth. You can see here that we have our previous force, and we're tacking onto it the force from the Earth. You can see Earth is right here. And so right now, what we have is this little block of code calculates the force on the sun from both Mercury and Earth and combines them into one single force. And then we know that since all the planets are aligned horizontally, there's no force in the y direction. And so this shows the x component of the force from both Earth and Mercury. Does anyone have any questions on how this works? Seems like everyone understands. Then we'll move on to Mercury. This works in almost the exact same way, and we're just going to run over it to make sure everyone understands. So here we have the force on Mercury in the x direction for the first time step. We first set it equal to zero to clear out the element in our list. And then what we do is we then tack on to this force, the force from the sun. You can see here. So from this line, we take into account the force from the sun. Now the next line, we're going to combine that with the force from the Earth. So line 94 is the force from the Earth. And so now we have all the forces at the very first moment for Mercury. We have both the force from the sun and the force from the Earth. And it works the exact same way as this did. And then finally, we have the exact same thing for the Earth. We have here, it clears out the first element in our list, clears out the first page in our flipbook. Then this calculates the force on the Earth from the sun, and then this combines it with the force on the Earth from Mercury, just like we did in the previous two blocks. Now, does anyone have any questions on how this combining of forces works in our code? All right, then we're going to move on to our for loop. Just before the for loop, what we're going to be doing here is we're going to have the computer plot out the planets as they move around. And so it's not just going to be one instantaneous plot, it's going to show kind of in a stop motion type of way how the planets move around. The way that we do that is by creating a little figure before the for loop. And this for loop is going to fill in this figure. It's going to rewrite this figure constantly over the course of the program. And so what this does is this opens a figure window that's ready to be written on. So now we're going to go into our for loop. This is very similar to what we've done in the previous programs. We have our for k is equal to 2 cnt max. And so now we go over the position and velocity of the sun. This is the exact same thing that we did yesterday. There's nothing different here. All of this is the same position and velocity equations that we've been learning since Tuesday and Wednesday, really, since even Monday. The second block are the position and velocity equations for Mercury. Now, these equations are the exact same equations that we're using for the sun and the earth, but now we're just replacing the sun and the earth with Mercury. And so these equations are the exact same equations that we did yesterday and on Wednesday and on Tuesday, but just for Mercury. The same finite difference time domain equations. And then third, we have our equations that we use for Earth. These are the exact same equations that we used yesterday and on Wednesday. And they model Earth in the exact same way. So nothing about the for loop right now is different, except that we've added another little piece for Mercury. So all we've done is added an identical piece that says Mercury on it. However, now what we need to know are the forces between them. And remember, the forces are different when we're using three objects instead of two. And so these forces are going to be calculated in a little bit of a different way. So first we have the forces for the sun. We first clear it out using this little command. And then we move on to calculating it. So you'll see here that we have different cosine and sine thetas. You see here that we have cosine theta Sm, which means cosine theta is between the sun and Mercury. And it works the exact same way as we did yesterday, except now we're doing it from, now we're calculating the force from the sun to Mercury in the x direction. And so these two lines calculate the direction and the force on the sun, and the force between the sun and Mercury in the x direction. Now we move on to the force on the sun in the x direction from Earth. So you can see here we have cosine theta SE, cosine theta sun Earth. And we have our very similar equation here. And finally, we have the force on the, we have this equation right here. Now, something interesting, we already calculated the force on the sun due to Mercury here. And so what we're doing in this command is we're taking the force on the sun in the x direction from Mercury and adding on the force on the sun in the x direction from Earth. And so you can see here, we have our previous force from Mercury. And then this calculates our new force due to Earth in the x direction. And now we do the exact same thing in the y direction. Instead of using cosine, we use sine, just like we did yesterday. And this shows the direction of the force from the sun to Mercury in the y direction. And then this shows us the amount of force from the sun from Mercury in the y direction. And now this does the exact same thing, But all it, the only extra thing it does is it adds on the force from Earth in the y direction. And so what's happened here is that we have the y component of the force from Mercury, which are these two lines. And then we add to that the y component of the force from Earth, which are these two lines. So what we've done is we've taken one force, the force from Mercury, we've added it to the force from Earth to get our final force. Does anyone have any questions on how we get the new force from the two smaller forces from Mercury and the Earth? Okay, then we'll move on to the exact same thing, but for Mercury. The exact same thing that's happened to Mercury. We see here we have cosine theta ms. This is the, this block right here is the force of gravity on Mercury from the sun in the x direction. And then what we do is we take that force from, we take the force on Mercury from the sun and we add to it the force on Mercury from the Earth, which is this. So we have our previous, so we have our force on Mercury from the sun, and then we add to it the force on Mercury from the Earth. And then this is for the X component, and we do the exact same thing for the Y component. We take the force on Mercury from the sun in the Y component here, and we add to it the force on Mercury from the Earth in the Y component here. So it's the exact same thing that happened to the sun, but now we're calculating it for Mercury. And then finally, we do the exact same thing for the Earth. We take the force on the Earth from the sun, and we add it to the force on the Earth from Mercury. And we do those same things in the Y component. We take the force on the Earth from the sun in the Y direction, and we add it to the force on the Earth from Mercury in the Y direction. And so what happens is that these three blocks of code, the force on the sun, the force on Mercury, and the force on the Earth, use the same principles as we did in yesterday's program, but now we're simply taking those individual forces and adding them together to get one new force. Does anyone have any questions on how we combine these forces to get one new force? All right, I think that we're ready to keep going. What this does, this displays our percent complete, just like we did yesterday. And then now we're moving on to plotting. Remember when I said that this program is going to plot our model as it calculates it? Well, this is how it calculates it. This is how it plots it. So what this does is it takes every 800th step, takes every 800th page and plots it out onto a little graph. And doing it every 800th page basically gives the computer time to calculate it and makes the entire program run much faster. And if you want a more accurate graph, you could change this to something like 200 or 100. And if you want the program to run faster, you could increase this to like 1,000. And so what this does is it takes what's happening in the for loop and plots it in real time to our graph to model what's happening do the planets. Does everyone understand how we've added Mercury into our two-body code to come up with our new three-body code? Does anyone have any questions on this? All right, then if everyone has this in front of them, then I think we are ready to run it. So everyone should save this and run it. And it should immediately come up with a figure that I'll show here. And this figure is actively plotting out our three-body problem.
Leo, mine? Okay, maybe it's the same as yours. Mine doesn't have a yellow sun, but it does have a looks like a blue sun.
That should be fine.
Okay, so that blue dot is the sun. Yes, moving microscopically.
The blue dot is the, all right, so who, has anyone who's run the program not been able to get this graph?
And I'm doing it on the times four also, so mine's slower?
Well, it will be slower if you do it on the times four. So who has not run this program yet? I think everyone's run it. So
I have, and it's a little bit different than your screen.
Does it still show the kind of the same thing with a little dot in the middle, then one ring, and then another ring? It might be different on Mac. That's the thing.
Yeah, it has, like, oh, wait, no, I think it's just loading, because I see it, like, slowly forming.
Yeah, I'm running this on a quite powerful computer, and it took a little bit of time, and so normal laptops may take more time to run this program.
Yeah, it's the same thing.
Leo, did yours stop at, like, not quite finished? Is that because of something?
This little gap right here is because I only did it every hour. Now, like I was saying before, the smaller you make your time step, the more accurate it will be. And so since I did mine only to the hour, it's not very accurate, and so I have this big gap right here. However, if I redid this to do it every quarter of an hour, this gap would be a lot tighter, but it would take a lot longer to plot this out.
Okay, because I'm doing mine every 15 minutes, the times four. It's closing more.
In fact,
actually, it's almost closed.
I'll do mine every 15 minutes just to show everyone or to let everyone confirm what they've done. So I'll go up here and I'll add my times four.
Yeah, mine's much closer.
This way. And so it's gonna take a lot longer. It's going to take a lot longer for my computer to process, and also my computer's making quite a lot of fan noise. But when it finishes, it's going to be much more accurate. And so you can see right now that it's going much more slowly. But when it finishes, it's going to show a more complete and accurate model of what's going on. My computer's making a lot of noise now. And so this demonstrates how changing the length of your time step changes the accuracy of your model. Because what's gonna happen now is that when this finishes, that gap is gonna be much smaller and this model is gonna be much more accurate. And that's a very important lesson about finite difference time domain. One of the big lessons is that the smaller you make your time step, the more accurate it's going to be, but it's also going to be more difficult for the computer to process because you're just doing more.
Oh, and it's not like it shaves off an hour at the end. It's that at every time step, it's shaving off, like it's not doing as
much. It's kind of like, for example, it's kind of like a screen resolution. If you're, it's like a, what's a good way to put this? It's like a screen resolution. Old TVs had a very bad screen resolution, which meant that each little dot was very big. It was very chunky. And with each of those dots, and since you could only fit a certain amount of dots onto your screen, if the dots were too big, everything looks pixelated. However, if you have a more high resolution screen, each of those little dots, each of those little pixels becomes smaller and you can fit more of them on there, which means that you can get a more accurate image, but it also means that it takes more processing power to produce that image. And so you can see here, my graph of the solar system has finished, and you can see that the gap has now decreased in size. And the reason why it has decreased in size is that I've made my model much more accurate by making our time step much smaller. And so now, with this program, we now know how to model multiple planets. We know how to model multiple objects. We have the sun right here that barely moves. We have Mercury right here, which has completed many orbits around the sun. And then we have Earth right here, which has almost completed one orbit, but because of the inaccuracy of our model, has left a little gap that's going to get smaller when we make our model more accurate. Now that we have our three-body model, what we're going to do now is we are going to change some of the initial conditions so that we can see what happens when we change some things about the solar system. So we're going to change some of the variables, and we're going to see how different planets move. So I'm going to go back to my Octave. And the first thing we're going to change is the mass of the sun. We are going to make the sun just a little heavier. So we go here, and we're going to make it 10 times heavier. In order for everyone to do this, we go up to line, it should be around line 13 for everyone. We go to the mass of the sun, M sun, and it's originally at 1.99 e to the 30th, and we're going to change it to 1.99 e to the 31st.
Could I see that again real quick?
Yes, right here.
Okay, I got it.
All right. And now, I'm just thinking if we need to change anything else. Or actually, a better experiment would be something like this. Let's change the mass of the sun back. So it's 1.99 times 10 to the 30th. So we're going to change the mass of the sun back. And what we're going to do instead is we're going to change the starting velocity of one of the planets. And so the way we do that is we go down to, let's say, Mercury right here. So let's go down to Mercury. And right here we have our starting velocity. And this starting velocity right now is set so that Mercury will always be in a stable orbit around the sun. However, what if we change that a little bit? What if instead of having Mercury always stay in a stable orbit around the sun, what if we increase it? And so how we can increase it is we can just multiply it by something times, let's say, 4. So now what we have is here is that we've set the velocity of Mercury at the very beginning of our model to be 4 times what it originally was. So has anyone not adjusted this step yet? Adjusting the velocity of Mercury?
Don't change anything else, but just multiply times 4 at the end of that.
Yes. All you have to do is take whatever was in your Vy underscore M and add times 4.
Okay.
So I'm going to give everyone a few more moments to do that. And now we're going to run it. I'm going to press run, and I will share my screen with people.
Oh, wow. Okay, right. Mercury has already jumped off of my chart.
Yeah.
And it's it's going to run. Right, because it's mine seems to have.
So it's just gone.
It's gone off the grid, right?
So fast. So Mercury has gone so fast that it's now escaped the sun's orbit.
That will also have an effect on Earth, right? Because as it goes farther away from Earth, it's going to have less of an effect on Earth's.
Exactly, that's very true.
So I should compare the Earth orbit from the figure 1.
Yeah, and so this demonstrates another principle that we learned about in our lecture. We know that, and that principle is that the distance between two objects has a greater effect on the force of gravity than the mass does. So for example, we have Mercury, we set the speed of Mercury to be so fast that it got far enough away from the sun so that it didn't feel a great amount of force. And so what's happened is that Mercury now left the sun so fast that the distance increased so much so that the sun could not hold it in its orbit. And so this is a very nice demonstration of a principle that comes up in Newton's law of gravity, that as you increase the distance between two objects, the force of gravity rapidly decreases.
Can I do it by times 2 to see
well, how? Well, yeah, to be more reasonable, I'll put a more reasonable example up. What we can do is we can, instead of doing it times 4, we can do something like times 1.5. This means that Mercury is going 50% faster. Instead of 4 times faster, it's just going 50% faster than what it normally was. And so now I'll run this again. And I'll share my screen. And so what we should see now is we should see Mercury curving because it's going slower.
Yeah. And I wonder if it'll come back around, or is it still going off? Wow, the speed has such an incredible effect.
It has a very large impact on it.
Because it deals with distance.
If you give the planets just a little bit of speed, they'll very quickly be thrown into a crazy orbit like this.
It might not ever come back here either, although it's
probably not within our time frame, but
right.
But it might if we had a very, very, very accurate and very long model of what would happen.
Can I ask Leo, Mercury's close to the sun. But you have planets like, or whatever Pluto is, planet, false planet. Pluto is so far out there. Why is it in any orbit?
Well, because Pluto is still in orbit around the sun because of two things. because of one thing, it's moving very slowly. The slower something moves, the more the sun has the ability to keep it in its orbit.
Yeah.
And so since Pluto is moving very slowly, it will stay within the sun's orbit.
Okay.
So now we're going to use one more example of Mercury speed. And what we're going to do now is we're going to, instead of doing 50% faster, we're just going to do 10% faster. And so now Mercury is moving at 110% of its actual speed. So we're going to change our 1.5 to 1.1. And then we should see that Mercury should probably stay within the sun's orbit, but it's not going to look as when it was in its actual speed. So I'll share my screen with everyone. So what we can see now is that Mercury is still trapped within the sun's orbit. However, it's moving much farther away from the sun than usual. You can see here that it started much closer to the sun than it ended up on the other side. And so this demonstrates how if you add a little bit of speed to the planet on this side, it will then move farther away from the sun when it reaches the other side of its orbit.
So something like a massive asteroid hitting one of these planets at just the right spot to increase their velocity a touch can have exceedingly bad consequences, or is that even possible?
It would have bad consequences, and it would have to be a very large asteroid.
Make it go faster.
Yeah. Or what could conceivably happen is if some large object passes through the solar system, even though it won't hit anything, it passes through the solar system, it might pull things away from the sun with its immense gravity.
Like a black hole.
Yeah. And so actually we can model something like that we can model something like that later, and I'll show you, and I'll show what that would look like just in a moment. So we can see here that when we increase the speed of Mercury just by 10%, you can see that it's changed the shape of its orbit. You can see that it's traveled much farther away from the sun than it started out as. And then it returned back to its original position. And so now we're going to model what Nicole was talking about, which is an object of larger mass coming in and disrupting the solar system. So what I'm going to have everyone do is I'm going to have everyone reset Mercury back to what it originally was. So make sure that Mercury speed, just take away your times 1.1 and just set it back to what it is like this. And now what we're gonna do is you're gonna go up to where we have our masses, M sun, M Mercury, and M Earth. And we're gonna simulate what happens when Mercury becomes very large. And so what we'll do is we'll take Mercury, and instead of having it 3.3 times 10 to the 23rd, we could set it to, let's say, 3.3 times 10 to the 28th. And so now Mercury is going to be a lot larger, and we're going to see what happens to the entire solar system now. So we can run this now, and I'll share my screen with everyone.
Ooh, look at the sun.
Yeah, you can see here this yellow, you can see a little bit of a yellow line. That shows you that that Mercury is actually pulling the sun along with it.
Uh-oh, Earth doesn't look good right now.
And Mercury will also have an increased effect on Earth. And so we'll see if Mercury is able to change the orbit of Earth in any way.
Certainly is already.
Yeah.
Tightening up, spiraling.
So this shows you that when you increase the mass of something, the gravitational force will also increase. And so when we increase the mass of Mercury, it had the effect of dragging the sun along with it, and the effect of changing slightly the orbits of the Earth.
Well, now that's interesting. Then the Earth started, oh, that's really weird.
And so you can see here that a change in Mercury's mass resulted in a large change in both the orbit of the Earth and the position of the sun here. Mercury has dragged the sun downwards on the graph as its increase.
It would make the orbit of Earth so unsteady, because as the sun moved, then you'd have, like, if the sun and the Mercury were moving in opposite directions, maybe it would be balanced. But as the sun moved with Mercury, it's pulling. It's not even a stable deformation, or I would imagine. You know what I mean? Like, if the sun's going sort of one way and Mercury's going the other way, versus the sun and Mercury being, I don't know, it seems like two masses pulling it.
Yeah, that's true. Now there are two, the mass of, the force of Mercury on the Earth is now much greater. And that's something that we showed in our slideshow that shows how all of the forces on each planet add up to make one final force. And if you increase the force from Mercury, it will change that force so that it'll pull Earth in a different direction.
So, Leo, I have a question.
Yes.
So, with this model, right?
Yeah.
You're changing these parameters like mass or the speed of the planet itself, but there's an initial velocity. Is that correct?
Yes.
So, is that assumption that this is already a stable system? Like, for example, what I'm trying to say is, there is a point at which, right, would this system as it is now become somehow stable? Or is this output that we're seeing a result that it's starting at a specific time with a specific velocity that doesn't have any retroactive continuity? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, well, yeah, the original result with the correct speeds and the correct masses,
mm-hmm.
That's designed based on both reality and math that makes it produce a stable orbit. So for example, down here, you see the square root of this big square root term. This basically means that it will always give the correct velocity for each of the planets to make sure that they're in a stable orbit. For circular motion around the sun.
Okay, so for example, when we had the initial velocity, we changed the initial speed of Mercury, right?
Yeah.
My simulation showed that it did a very large ellipsis and then it came back.
Exactly, yeah. If you change this, it will give it a very elliptical orbit. And elliptical, for people that don't know, elliptical basically means that instead of being perfectly circular, it gets really close to the sun and then travels very far away and then comes back to the sun and travels very far away. And so adjusting the speeds will produce an interesting elliptical orbit.
Okay. And if you were to run the simulation with slightly tweaked, like instead of 1.1, 1.5, which is where I got an elliptical orbit, if you were to continue that past 365, if you extended that time,
it would. If the model was accurate enough, it would actually bring Mercury back.
Okay.
Keep doing an elliptical orbit.
Okay. That's interesting. Thank you.
Something else we could do, let's say another interesting experiment we can do. What if we increase the mass of Mercury, not just to just below the sun, but what if we make it even larger than the sun? And so for this experiment, let's say that Mercury is just a little bit larger than the sun. And so it's going to be 3.3 times 10 to the 30th. You can see here that the sun is 1.99 times 10 to the 30th. And so what we're going to be modeling right now is what happens if Mercury is 3 times larger than the sun. So we'll run this model right now, and I'll share my screen. And this is what happens.
Oh my God, what does that even mean?
So what's happened here? So what's happened here is that Mercury, the pink or purple line, whatever you see it, is so massive that it's taken the sun and it's pulled it out of its original position, and it's turning the sun and Mercury into a little system. And so what's going to happen is that as the sun and Mercury move forward, they're going to encounter one another and then separate, just like they did here. See, the sun and Mercury come closer together. They made an encounter at about here, and then they separated. And what's happened with the Earth is that the Earth has gotten very close to Mercury. And remember, when things get close to when the objects get closer, the forces increase, and that increased force on the Earth produced such an enormous acceleration that the Earth has been kicked out. So it started here, it's encountered with Mercury, and then it's been kicked out of the solar system. And so this shows, this basically shows what would happen if, for example, another star came into the solar system. Another star would come in and it would pull the sun away from its position, and it would pull all the planets towards it and then slingshot them outwards, just like what happened with the Earth. You can see that the Earth came close to Mercury and then was slingshotted outwards out of the solar system. And so this is basically an example of what would happen if some large object, like a star, came into the solar system unexpectedly and disrupted everything. And so now I'll take some suggestions for new experiments from you guys. So anyone who wants to suggest something about our model that we can change to produce some interesting result. Anyone can take a guess.
3.3E100?
Oh, well, what that would do, that would, well, we could do that. E to the 100, that means that it's, I'm not even sure Octave could calculate that. What we're probably going to do, instead of E to the 100, I don't think Octave is going to like that, but we can try it. E to the 100.
So wait, 3.3 E to the 100 for Mercury.
So this means that it's going to be three, so that the mass of Mercury in kilograms is going to be 3.3 with, it's going to be 33 with 100 or 99 zeros behind it.
Is my computer going to catch fire if we do this? Okay, let's do it.
I'm not sure. Remember, if your computer is really running slowly while this happens, what you can do, you can go back to your command window and you can do Control C or Command C and it will stop whatever's going on.
Okay, I'm also taking off the times four for the count max.
Yeah, that would probably be a good idea as well.
I'm doing it.
All right, so.
My computer's taking a while for it to load, so I think that
it'll take a good amount of time.
Oh, yeah. No, mine went. So I have a dot for the sun, a dot for the Earth, and then a straight line up for Mercury.
Remember we made our model less accurate, and so it might not have actually been able to calculate what's going on.
Well, I have, it's just that it flew out and even also, before the Earth started really going.
Also, Mercury might be so heavy that it hasn't been slowed down at all by the other planets.
Its inertia is too
high. And because Mercury hasn't been slowed down at all, it just flies out of the solar system because nothing in the solar system can hold it back.
It's like you're running next to mosquitoes. Oh, Leopold?
Yeah.
What about increasing the mass of the sun? Isn't the concept that at some point in the future, the sun will sort of implode and then explode and become like a, what do they call, a red dwarf or something like that?
Well, that would be decreasing the mass of the sun.
Okay, why don't we, could you maybe do that?
All right. Yeah, we can do that. So we'll take our mass of Mercury and bring it back to
23. 23 is okay. E23. All right.
And what we can do now is take our mass of the sun and instead of times 10 to the 30th, we could do E29.
Okay.
Remember that one of our things is that the velocity of all of our planets are going to be calculated by this equation, which makes sure that they're in a proper orbit. And so also what we're gonna do, I'm gonna add back times four to our CNT max to make this more accurate.
Okay.
And then we'll run it.
I had to force quit Octave because it wasn't loading. So I have to redo what we just did.
Okay.
Oh, but then don't forget to delete those lines, right? Right, Leo?
And so what's going to happen now is that since we decreased the mass of the sun, the planets are going to move a lot more slowly. And since we decreased the mass of the sun, we decreased the gravitational force on all the planets. And and the planets will run a lot more slowly.
So is it just that the planets will go more slowly, but it'll change, but if they're going more slowly, it'll change.
But remember, when we decrease the mass of the sun, the equation that we use to calculate the initial velocity of the Earth and Mercury also changed so that they would always be in a stable orbit. And what meant is that the equation now sets the Earth and Mercury to a slower initial speed.
So what about that? Because didn't they say that the sun will slowly subsume the Earth over, you know, millions of years?
Well, what will happen is that the sun will expand, but it won't increase in mass. What's happening is that the sun will increase in volume.
Okay.
So the sun will get bigger, but it's not actually getting more massive. It's kind of like, it's going to be like a balloon. When you inflate a balloon, it gets bigger, but you don't add any more rubber to it. And so it doesn't get that much heavier. Yeah. And that expansion, because it's not gaining any more mass, it won't affect how much gravity it produces. And so now my model is finished. And what's happened is that since we've decreased the mass of the sun, we've also decreased the force of the sun. And when we decrease the force that the sun produces due to gravity, it also decreases the speed that it pulls the planets around with. And so what we're left with is Earth going very slowly and only completing about a third of its orbit within 1 year. All right. And so now what we're going to do, now that we've gone through our model of the Earth, the Sun, and Mercury, now that we understand how to add more planets, what we're going to do is we are going to now open up our solar system designer, which is going to be our full program for many different planets. So I have it open right here, but I'm going to give everyone a few minutes to open this new program called Solar System Designer. We should have sent this to everyone in an email. And there are a couple ways of getting to this. First, you can either just open up the program in Octave, or if for some reason that doesn't work, you can take the program in the email, you can copy the program, all of it, and then paste it into a new program. But what I would recommend for everyone doing is to just open this program into Octave straight from your email. And so anyone that's having problems with that, I can help them. And then in a few moments, we'll come back and we'll investigate the Solar System Designer program.
I guess I was sort of also interested, we could do this later. What happens if we make Mercury smaller? It would just...
Well, what would happen is that if Mercury becomes smaller, it wouldn't have that large of an effect.
Okay.
It would still move around the sun at the same speed. And It would basically do it's the exact same thing. All the interesting things happen.
Because it's being pulled both by the sun and the earth. That's what, so it kind of keeps a balance, right?
Yeah. And so is anyone having problems with getting the solar system designer program running in Octave? Does anyone need help opening up the solar system designer? So I think, does everyone have solar system designer open?
Yes. I do.
Leo, should we run it?
Not yet. We're going to go through what happens. We're going to go through the program first, and we're going to look at how we took the concepts from our three-body problem and applied them to make our final solar system designer. And we added a few things onto our solar system designer that weren't added into our three-body problem. So I assume no one has said that they're having problems opening it. So I'm going to assume that everyone has this open, and we'll move through it and we'll see what's happened. And so this solar system designer, we're going to take our old program, three body problem, and we've added two things to it. We've added the moon and we've added Jupiter. And so, adding these two objects will finally solidify in everyone's head how to add new planets. And so, we can use this technique that we're going to show you to add any new planet, any new satellite, any new star to your model. So we have the same CNT max, the year, and delta T, and we just do the exact same thing that we did in our three-body problem. We have the empty pages for the sun, the empty pages for Mercury, the empty pages for the Earth. Now we're getting into some of the new stuff. The empty pages for the moon, the empty pages for, and then finally the empty pages for Jupiter. So we're using the exact same method that we did when we added Mercury in, but now we're just doing it for the moon and for Jupiter. And now we're calculating the initial forces. And so here are the forces on the sun. And what this does is this adds up all of the x components of every single force that's being applied to the sun. So here we have the force on the sun from Mercury plus the force on the sun from Earth plus the force on the sun from the moon plus the force on the sun from Jupiter. And then we do everything for Mercury. The force on Mercury from the sun, the force on Mercury from the Earth, the force on Mercury from the moon, and the force on Mercury from Jupiter. Then we do the same thing for the Earth, all the forces. The same thing from the moon, all the forces. And then the same thing for Jupiter, all of the forces. Does anyone have any questions on how we added the moon and Jupiter to our model? We added it the exact same way that we added Mercury to our previous model. All right, I think everyone seems to be good then. So now what these two things do is these create two figures. The first figure is going to be our, the first figure is going to be our entire solar system. And the second figure is going to be a special figure that's going to be close up on the Earth and the Moon. Now our for loop is almost exactly the same. We have our finite difference time domain equations for the sun, all the same things. We have the FD-TD equations for Mercury, all the same things. We have our FDTD equations for the Earth, all the same things. Then we have the same equations for the moon, the exact same as we did for all of the other bodies, but now we're doing it for the moon. And then we have them for Jupiter, right here. And so now the for loop has calculated the position and the velocity. The position, the acceleration, and the velocity of all of the different planets. Now we need to know what all the forces are, the new forces. And so these blocks of code allow us to find the new forces for all the different bodies. So first we have the sun, and it works the exact same way as our three body problem. All we just have is more of it. And so here we have the force on the sun from the force on the sun from Mercury, the force on the sun from the Earth, the force on the sun from the moon, which we use the letter L for lunar, the force on the sun from the moon, and the force on the sun from Jupiter. And then we have all of those same components in the y dimension as well. So here are all of the forces in the x dimension and all of the forces in the y dimension. And now we do the same thing for Mercury. We have the force from Mercury from the sun, the force on Mercury from the Earth, the force on Mercury from the moon, and the force on Mercury from Jupiter. And so these are all the forces in the x direction, and these are all the forces in the y direction. And now we do the exact same thing for Earth. All the forces in the x direction on Earth, and then we have all the forces on the y in the y direction from Earth.
Can I just make a comment that it's it's incredible that this is all based on right triangle calculations.
It is all based on right triangle calculations. You can see here that we have our square root of both of our sides squared. These are all based on right triangle calculations. That's all you need for two dimensions.
So the Pythagorean theorem, it's just incredible.
The Pythagorean theorem and the sine and cosine, and that's it.
Wow.
And so we have the same thing for the moon, all the forces in the x direction, and then all the forces in the y direction. Then finally we have everything for Jupiter, all of the forces in the x direction, and all of the forces in the y direction. And we add the moon and Jupiter into our model in the exact same way that we added Mercury into our model in the three body problem. Does anyone have any questions on the process behind adding the moon and adding Jupiter? So it seems like everyone understands, and we can finish up with our plots. So this again does the exact same plot every 800 steps. And then we do another plot for the Earth and the Moon system. And so now what we can do, now that everyone's reviewed this code, we can now run it. We can go up here, save file and run. And now we have two figures. And I'll show everyone my first figure here, which is the solar system. And then I'll share everyone my second figure, which is the Earth and the Moon. And so this is going to take a while for your computer to do. But once you're finished, I'll see when I finish. I'm almost finished right now. And now I'm finished. And so here what we have, here in figure one, we have our model of the solar system with Mercury, Earth, Jupiter, and the sun. So here, this little dot here is the sun. It's so massive that it hasn't moved. Then this little pink ring around it is Mercury. You can see that in proportion to everything else, Mercury is very close to the sun. And actually, since it's so close to the sun, it's moving really fast. Then this blue line here is Earth. And then way out here, this red line is the path of Jupiter. And so one of the things you can see is that Jupiter, compared to all the other planets, is very far away. So compared to Mercury and compared to Earth, Jupiter is very far away from the sun. And another consequence of that is that Jupiter moves very slowly, even though some of it is hidden behind this legend. Jupiter has barely moved an eighth of its entire orbit. And so this shows you a total model of what we've done so far for the solar system, model with all of the interactions accounted for. Now,
Leo, could you remove your legend so we can see what happens with Jupiter?
All right, I'll take off the legend.
I won't take it off on mine, but maybe on your.
Just to show more.
All right, so I'll show everyone how to
comment it.
I'll show everyone how to take off the legend.
Okay.
We're going to go back to editor. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take these two. So we're going to go to our if statement. Remember where we plotted everything? So right after all these forces, we're going to go down here to our plotting and formatting. And what we're going to look at is we're going to look at these two lines. You see here it starts with H5 and then set. And then in order to remove our legend, all we do is just comment it. And so we just add a percent symbol in front of them. And that tells the computer to ignore these two. That little percent sign at the beginning tells the computer to ignore these two lines.
Okay.
And then we can do that the same way for these two again. We see here the legend and the set. So all we're gonna do is comment these two by adding the percent symbol.
Okay.
And so we've commented, and so what we've done is we commented line 435, 436, and line 452 and 453. We've added percent symbols to turn them into comments. And now what we can do is we can now run the program again to show Jupiter's full orbit. So I'll show everyone my screen. And so this is what our new model of the solar system should be like without the key.
Okay. Is Jupiter's velocity about the same as What's its velocity?
No, Jupiter's velocity is much lower than the other planet's velocity, because remember, it's much farther away. Since Jupiter is much farther away from the sun than Mercury and the Earth are, Jupiter is experiencing a lot less force due to gravity. And because it's experiencing less force, it doesn't have to move as fast in order to avoid falling into the sun.
Okay.
And so now that we know this, does anyone have any suggestions on how to mess the solar system up?
Could I ask another thing? I'm sorry. But for the moon, I see that it keeps crisscrossing back and forth. That's the orbiting around the Earth, right?
Yes. And yeah, it keeps crisscrossing back and forth because the moon is constantly orbiting around the Earth as the Earth moves forward. And so now we can find ways to change the solar system to change how everything works. And so does anyone have any suggestions on what we can change to get some strange result?
Can you make Jupiter large? Because I know that Jupiter is supposed to be a big, like, asteroid sink, right? Protects us from asteroid and stuff. So
you can make Jupiter much larger. In fact, we can do that right now. And so in order to make Jupiter larger, what I want everyone to do is we want to go back to the top of our program. And once we get to the top of our program, we want to go to M Jupiter, right here at line 20. And we're going to change this from times 10 to the 27 times 10 to the 29. Or actually, we can change it times 10 to the 30th. So we're going to make Jupiter almost the exact same size as the sun.
Oh.
And so now we're going to see what happens when we increase its mass. So we're going to save file and run. And I'll share everyone my screen. And so we'll see if we can see any change. We can already see Mercury is being pulled towards Jupiter. And we can see that Earth's orbit around the sun is starting to be disrupted.
Wow. So if you continued this beyond just the 1 year,
you would see that both Mercury and the Earth would start going towards Jupiter. And so that's actually something we can do. We can increase the amount of time that we want. And so what we can do, we can go back to our program. And we can go to our year. And we can do this for example, 2 years. So we can multiply it by two. And so this allows us to show what happens, what would happen if we ran the model for 2 years. And so you can see here that we get an interesting result. We get both the Earth and Mercury moving closer and closer to Jupiter.
Okay, Leo, I'm sorry. I tried to make the change on mine, but I got, where do I count max? I can put 365 times 24 times 2?
No. So where you go, so you not to the CNT max, you go below to the year. You see right here where it says year?
Okay, hold on one second. I have to, it's so small. Just a second. Yeah, okay.
And so you take this year command and you multiply it by 2 to tell the computer that you want 2 years worth of data.
Okay, now let me run it.
And so when you're finished, your model should look something like this. And this shows that as Jupiter has gotten more massive, the other planets are beginning to be pulled towards Jupiter.
What about the moon?
The moon, I think,
is getting farther from Earth.
Here's the moon. The moon has been kicked out.
Ooh. Right, my Earth is all by itself now.
Exactly. And so, and so this shows how when we increase the mass of Jupiter, it not only pulls the Earth and Mercury towards it, but it also rips the moon away from Earth
and brings it into orbit around Jupiter, or something happens to Jupiter.
It would appear here if that happened. We don't know what's happened. And so also what you can see here very faintly, I'll share my original solar system again. You can see a very faint yellow dot, a very faint series of yellow dots here. That shows you that the sun is being moved as well. And so the sun is being pulled towards Jupiter. I see that someone has just rejoined after leaving for a few minutes. And what we've been doing so far is we've been showing how this large solar system model uses the exact same principles as our three-body problem to add in Jupiter and the moon to our whole model. And so does anyone else have any suggestions on what we can change to get some extraordinary result for our model? I'll change this back to what we were doing.
Leo?
Yes.
Can my dad share his screen? Because something really interesting happened.
Sure.
Okay.
I'll let him share his screen. You should be good now. Oh yes, that's exactly what happened on us, on my screen as well. Pierre?
Oh, but look how the sun, I'm not sure I could see it on yours, but the sun is completely pulled off on its own trajectory.
Exactly, and you can see how the Earth and Mercury followed the sun as the sun is being pulled towards Jupiter.
And Mercury kind of like winds around the sun.
It does, it loops around it because they always want to, because they want to orbit what's closest to them, and what's closest to them is the sun.
But if the closer it gets to Jupiter, it might jump ship and just start orbiting Jupiter altogether. Well, that's, I guess, true. The sun is just a smidge more massive.
That's true.
Could it sort of become a binary star system where like they go back and forth or?
That's exactly what that's called, a binary star system. What would happen is that the sun and Jupiter would start orbiting each other and then everything else would start orbiting that large pair.
That is fairly catastrophic for Earth and our lifestyle, but.
Yeah, that's not so good for us. So I'll have everyone reset everything back to where it was before. Does anyone else have any suggestions on what we can change? Something that I've wanted to do, what I find pretty interesting is decreasing the mass of some, decreasing the initial velocity of some planets. Because what that will do, it'll basically bring them closer to the sun, and then it will pull them much farther away from the sun. And so one suggestion I would do right now is to go to Jupiter. Remember all the Jupiter blank pages? And you can see down here that we have the velocity of Jupiter at the beginning. And what I think would be a very interesting experiment is for everyone to take that velocity and decrease it by multiplying it by something that's less than one. So for example, 0.8. This means when you multiply this initial velocity of Jupiter by 0.8, it basically means that Jupiter's going to be going 20% slower than it was before we made this change. And so I'm gonna have everyone.
Oh, Leo, but can you also remind me what the original mass of Jupiter is? Because mine's still at E30.
The original mass of Jupiter was 1.989 e to the 26th.
26, okay. All right.
So whatever, and so what I want everyone to do is I want everyone to go and change the initial velocity of Jupiter to to multiply it by 0.8, just like this, so that it's going 20% slower.
And run.
And now we're going to run. And I'll share my.
And I still have 2 years, so it's going to give a.
It's, yeah, it'll give you 2 years then. And so now what we should see is Jupiter start to fall more quickly towards the sun. And so this is going to basically model what's going to happen. So for Gabriella, what we just did is in your code, we went to about line 107, and we took the that large term. I'll share my screen with you to show you what we did. We went to about line 107, and we took the velocity of Jupiter, this term, and we multiplied it by 0.8 to decrease the speed of Jupiter by 20%.
It was also something we had to revert back.
Oh yes, that was up here. We originally, for one experiment, we set Jupiter to a much larger mass. And so you should make sure that your mass of Jupiter, M Jupiter, is equal to 1.989 e to the 26th. That's the proper mass of Jupiter.
And then run?
And then run it, yes. And so what we can see here is that this graph doesn't look all that much different, but what's happened is that Jupiter has now moved a little bit closer to the sun. The end of Jupiter here is just a little bit closer to the sun than it was before.
I did it with 2 years and it's more obvious.
Yeah.
It's definitely curving in.
I'll do it with 2 years right now, actually.
Or even 3 years, it's probably gonna.
All right, so I'll go And with our year, we're going to go to line 25 with our year, and we're going to multiply our years by 3. So now we want 3 years. And so we'll run it again. And I'll show people what happens with the 80% velocity after 3 years. And so you can see here that the effect is much more pronounced. You can see that Jupiter is going a little closer to the sun than it would be if we kept the velocity the same. And later, we're going to decrease the speed of Jupiter even more so that we can see a truly catastrophic experience. And so now, yeah, and so this, and so now that we've decreased the speed of Jupiter by 20%, we can see that it's getting much closer to the sun than it was before, because it doesn't have enough speed to keep its orbit in a nice perfect circle. And so now our final little demonstration, we are going to decrease the speed of Jupiter even further.
Oh, can I say something? I'm sorry. So, and this also, with the 3 years, you see that it's starting to accelerate its course towards the sun as it reacts more to the sun's
That's true.
Mass. Because
as it gets closer to the sun, it's the distance between the sun and Jupiter decrease. And remember that as the distance decreases, the force between them rapidly increases. And because of that, Jupiter will begin accelerating towards the sun at a faster and faster rate. And so our final demonstration for today, our Jupiter blank pages. We're gonna go back to line 107, and we're gonna take our 0.8 and we're gonna change it to 0.5. So now Jupiter's only going to be moving half as fast as it was previously. And so now we are going to save and run this, and we're going to see how much of an impact this has on our model. And so this should have a very great impact. Jupiter should fall towards the sun much faster than previously anticipated.
Oh my God.
So you can see here that Jupiter is quickly diving towards the sun.
It'll also affect Earth's orbit though, right? Because it's coming.
It probably will. As it gets closer to inside the solar system, it might kick some planets out.
Oh my God.
And so you can see here that by cutting the speed of Jupiter in half, we've gotten it to go much closer to the sun.
And maybe pull some planets away with it if we kept, like, you know, more years going.
Exactly. That's probably what would have happened. And so that's the end of today's course. And before everyone leaves, we have a little surprise for everyone. We are going to, everyone that's been enjoying the class is going to be getting a little, is going to be getting a little certificate for doing such a great job with our octave coding. So I have the certificates and I'll just download them now. Hold on 1 second, let me just get these certificates. So, and so for all the kids, we are going to be giving all of them certificates. So I'll show everyone their certificate in a moment. And after you see it, you can choose to have it either emailed to you or we can send it to you physically through the mail.
Leopold?
Yes?
Not being a kid, I still want a certificate.
Right now we have all the certificates for the kids prepared, and if anyone else wants a certificate, they can tell us and we'll make one, and we'll make one for them.
I'd like one too.
All right. Well, all right. And so our first certificate is for Sophia Nwai for hard work and a complete understanding of the physics of orbital motion and octave, awarded today on July 17th, 2020.
Thank you. Oh my God.
Sophia, do you want us to, do you want us to email it to you or do you want us to prepare a physical copy for you?
Could you prepare a physical copy?
All right, we'll give it to you when we next see you then.
Thank you.
Our next certificate is for Gabriella for hard work and complete understanding of the physics of orbital motion and octave. Gabriella, do you want us to email it to you or do you want us to mail you a high quality copy of this?
First, thank you. What were the options again?
You could have both, but the options were you could either have it emailed to you or we could send it to you on proper high quality paper, or you could have both.
Proper high quality paper.
All right, we will send you your certificate of completion on high quality paper soon. And then finally, our last certificate is for Alexander Krauss, again, for hard work and a complete understanding of the physics of orbital motion and programming in octave. Xander, would you want your certificate sent to you through the mail on proper quality paper, or would you want it emailed to you?
I would like it sent to me through the mail.
All right, that sounds great. Then we'll send everyone their certificate through the mail. They should get it. They should be getting them sometime soon.
Probably, yeah.
And now that marks, and we'll get a certificate for all of the adults later and prepared, and we'll send it to them as well. And that marks the end of our physics and octave course. I hope everyone had a great time, and anyone can stay back for any questions or any comments about the course.
Leo, thank you so much. This was so informative and just great. It's just really good job.
Yeah,
Leo. So listen, I just wanted to say, Leo, a bunch of us here have taught at the university level, okay? And I can tell you that you did an absolutely stellar job. It was so impressive. You're amazing. Thank you so much. That was a fantastic experience, both for Sophia and I, and you know, you did just a great job. I can't thank you enough. It was fantastic, Leo. Good job.
You're here. I agree. Amazing, Leo. I didn't think I'd be able to understand any of the math, and I did. I didn't think I'd be able to understand the coding, and I did. Thank you.
That's all thanks to you. So thank you so much, Leo. That was amazing. Really, very impressive.
Thank you. Also, what we're probably going to do, we're going to have these, we're going to have this video uploaded later tonight, and then we'll be emailing everyone a folder with all of the programs that we've worked on so far in the course, so that everyone can have one neat and organized folder with all of our work from this week.
Oh, that's great. Thank you, Leopold. That was spectacular. We really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Leopold. I just really learned a lot.
I hope everyone had I hope everyone learned a lot and had a great time doing it.
You did. Bye, Leopold.
Thank you.
So awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Bye.
Goodbye.